joining us to this My Father's Dragon panel today. We're very excited and honored to have these creatives here with us to share some behind-the-scenes insights and some artwork as well and other stories. Before we begin, I want to go over a few quick guidelines. Please, there's no recording or photos during the presentation. You're free to take photos after the presentation. And restrooms are upstairs, and please silence your cell phones. We're going to start with a sort of show-and-tell portion. And then after the presentation, we'll go into a Q&A with myself, as well as open it up to questions from you guys, and maybe some from Twitch as well. And and go from there. So now I'd like to introduce to you guys director Nora Twomey. And screenwriter Meg LeFauve. And with that, I'll just hand it over to Nora. Thank you.
Hey, everyone. Thanks so much for coming along evening? It is evening now. have you all seen the trailer? Because I won't bother playing it if you've all seen it. Anybody not seen the trailer? Okay, so I can see that there's some who haven't, so I'm just going to play it. It's quick. It's only 2 minutes. It gives a little sense of the film and what it's about. So here we go.
My father was born a long time ago.
Morning, everyone.
Morning, Elmer.
Morning, Elmer.
He lived in a world that seemed like it would go on forever. The times got hard.
Elmer!
And he was a child like any other, prone to scraped up knees and flights of fancy.
Why is everything so hard?
This is where I can help. You were kind to me. I'm going to return that kindness to you, Elmer. Just sitting there on this little tiny island, an amazing, spectacular, real, live...
Oh, dragon? My name is Elmer.
My name's Boris. Not as cool, but it goes with my face.
My father would soon set foot in places no child had ever been before. Dangerous.
Elmer!
Wild.
Help!
Strange places.
That's what I'm going to look like after I get my fire. When I save the island.
You save Wild Island? You're pulling my leg. Hey, stop pulling my leg!
You already saved the island. I saw you do it.
No, that's the way Seiwa made me do it. But it can't be right because it just sinks worse the next time.
There must be a way to figure it out.
I brought this dragon to us. We will track him and the child.
What do I do now, Elmer?
Don't worry, because I'm coming with you. We're gonna do it together.
You always know what to do.
Come on, we have to get out of here.
You don't seem to be scared of anything.
Get him!
I'll look after you.
This really was my lucky day. And tomorrow's gonna be even luckier.
Okay, so you get a sense of what the film is like. It's a 2D animated feature. I'm going to hand over to Meg to just get a sense of what the origins of the film were.
So that is from a book called My Father's Dragon, written by Ruth Stiles Gannett in 1948. She's still alive, 99 I believe she is now. I read the book to my children when they were little, one of whom's a large teenager here in the audience today. It took us 12 years after optioning the book to come here today. I optioned it with a friend of mine, John Morgan, who is my writing partner, who unfortunately passed away before we went to script stage. And we brought it to a producer, and we sat down, Julie and I, the producer, and said, who in our wildest dreams would be the person we would love to create this movie? And we both said Cartoon Saloon at the same time. Because truly being able to work with Cartoon Saloon and Nora is like winning the lottery, especially for a writer. And Julie went to Ireland and spoke to Nora about it. And the funny story is Julie's at the meeting in Ireland pitching hard to get Nora onto this project. And Nora is pitching hard to get Julie to let her do the project until they both realized, wait a minute, we're both pitching to each other. Let's just do it. John and I wrote many, many, many treatments because the book is a very simple story, and Elmer gets to the island and then meets ferocious animals that he uses stuff in his backpack to get by, and at the end of the book, he frees the dragon. But we knew that we wanted the main relationship of the movie to be with the dragon. Nora had this beautiful idea that it really be about two boys on an adventure, so the dragon is not a pet. He is a friend, another boy, that they're having an adventure together. And so, but we had no, if he meets the dragon at the end of the first act, what's the second act? So John and I had to really invent the story for the movie. That is why it's inspired by. And I remember the day that John called and said, what if the island is sinking? Because as you'll see, when you watch it on Netflix, November 11th, Elmer had to move and he's really lost his mom. She's so overwhelmed with anxiety and the poverty. She's starting to become angry and lost in her own way. And he is so overwhelmed by this adult problem that he goes to the island to get a dragon to fix his problem. If he could bring this dragon back, he could make a lot of money. And I remember when John called me and said, what if what Act Two is about in terms of stakes and what's happening is the island is sinking? Because it's a great metaphor, right? For what it feels like when that time in your life, when you feel like your life is sinking. And it's just so scary. And then we worked a lot with Nora on many drafts to get it going and sold it to Netflix and wrote many drafts of the script after that. It's an iterative process, art, right? I'm sure a lot of you are artists here, you know. You do many drawings, we do many drafts. But it was really about, my job then is to work with Nora to find out what is the movie that she wants to tell.
Thank you, Meg, and it was winning the lottery to work with you too. I learned so much on this project. And digging into the character's emotional arc and realizing that, that's the same as the plot, I think was something that was a bit of a revelation to me during this film, because seeing how nicely it all plays together, if you get that right, then when an animator asks, why does my scene exist, you can answer them, really honestly, as how it furthers the character's journey towards the climax of the film. These are all kind of things that really kind of hit home with me this time around. in terms of everything that Meg has talked there about the origins of the film and how, you know, as the scripts were, we were working through the scripts and developing exactly what it was that the world needed to be for Elmer to have a satisfying emotional arc. We also began to look at the tone of the film in terms of, I think there's something about, we can all read a script and we all have different, like slightly different readings of that script in our head, and we all see different movies. So when I began to work with our visual team in particular, they really wanted to know what's the tone of the film, you know, what does it feel like? So films like The Wizard of Oz, which is a childhood favorite of mine, I used to watch it on TV long before I ever even got to see what the inside of a cinema looked like. The feeling of that film was something that I wanted to find something similar for My Father's Dragon. The whole kind of, you know, Odyssey-esque kind of journey of something like Brother, Where Art Thou was something that I felt it was similar enough to as well. And then Iron Giant is just a film that I admire so, so much. But it does remind me, I think I was a student when it came out first. This is going to be spoilerish if in case anybody, but I'm sure everybody's seen it at this point. I remember as a student watching The Iron Giant and feeling a little bit at the very end of the film where we see the little bits and pieces of the giant come together again. I felt as a student thinking, oh no, they should have just left the film with the sacrifice of that the giant made for the town and for the child. And then revisiting it, I'd say a good 15 or more years later when I became a mother myself and watched that film with my own children. And I was so grateful for that ending.
I bet.
Those little nuts and bolts kind of making their way together again to start to form the giant and realize that my own understanding of the film had changed quite a lot. And that kind of intellectual student kind of thing had left me, and I saw it from an emotional level where you know, the children in particular need to have hope, and the hope that that we managed to get into My Father's Dragon is something that I looked at first for in The Iron Giant, because I think that was a huge lesson to me as a storyteller, beginning to understand story from that perspective and from the perspective of a parent, remembering what it's like to be a child rather than intellectualizing about it. And so that was a big eye-opener to me. Tone is also something that you get not just from the crew that you're working with. So we worked with 300 people, 150 of whom were artists. We had an amazing team all around. The person here with the 8 on her shirt is Amy Lippens, who is a casting director, and she helped us pull together an amazing team, a voice cast for our project, because as an animator, I know that you can't make a great animation performance of a character unless your voice cast understand their characters deeply and they believe that they are the character as they are giving the voice performance. And so Amy helped us pull together an amazing cast. And when I got to record with each of these actors, I'd learned, you know, over 20 years, well, I suppose maybe 20 years ago, or actually I'm no good at maths, that's why I'm a director and not a production manager. A long time ago, I learned on The Secret of Kells that actors really do just want you to help them do their best work. They don't care if you make them do 20 takes or one take or whatever, but they do want you to help them do their best work. And the only way to do that as a director is to help guide them. I do anything that it takes in the room with an actor in order to help get the performance there. Lots of actors are very generous. They'll allow you in behind the glass with them. I will literally run around the studio with them because they have nothing besides a microphone, a dark room, a script, and they need you to help them understand what the physicality of the character is, even like how to pitch the voices, like how far away is the camera from them at a particular moment. So I just facilitate the actors as best I can, knowing that they want me to help them do their best work. We didn't have a lot of people watching Whoopi Goldberg when she was doing her recording. That would have been really off-putting for her. But working during a pandemic meant that we did get to share a lot of the different processes between departments, which was a big revelation. Zara, who's in our audience here, who is our line producer, every Friday got our entire crew together over Zoom meetings, and we would share, hey, look, we recorded Whoopi, you know, this week, and this is what she sounded like, and this is what how that went. And that helped pull our team together, because a lot of our team were, you know, well, all of our team were at the edges of their kitchen tables, or they were, you know, in their living rooms, or trying to share a space, you know, with other activities and things like that. But it meant that our team felt like a team, even though we were separated quite a bit during the pandemic. We worked between Cartoon Saloon and Faust Studios. Faust Studios in Paris did about 30 minutes of the animation, and the rest was done in Cartoon Saloon. We have a big, long relationship with Faust. Didier Brunet, who set up Faust and Folivari Studios in Paris, was the first producer to come on board with The Secret of Kells, the first to bring money to the project that wasn't just a little bit of development money, but was actual production money. And that meant that other producers came on board and other financiers came on board and put money behind our projects really early on. So we good old friends in Paris. So just talking about the style of the, how we came, you know, came to the style that you see as evident in the trailer there. We started with the book that was, as Meg said, first published in 1948. Ruth Stiles Gannett's stepmother, whose name was also Ruth, did these beautiful illustrations, and they showed us the style of illustration that was apparent in the book. Gave a lovely sense of pattern, right? So there's the sense of pattern to the book, which feeds into the story themes of, so Elmer is a boy who has a particular pattern in his life. It feels kind of predictable. He kind of knows what's around every corner, and until he doesn't, until things start to fall apart from him, for him. And so for us, the use of pattern was really interesting in the book, and something that we played with. We either had it or we didn't have it. You know, we either ripped it apart or we had it, you know, very present in the scenes in the film. So we were both inspired by that, and we were also inspired by children's drawings. So the children's drawings, this is a drawing that one of my children did when they were 7 years old. I think it's amazing because it represents a human sacrifice. There's a guy behind a Roman soldier there that egging on the sea beast that's just about to eat this guy. I keep this drawing with me because it reminds me that children, whatever they imagine, they're going to find challenges anyway, whether you present it to them in stories and whether you have, like, you know, extremely responsible storytellers like Meg with you on that journey to talk with children through story about what, you know, challenges that they're going to face in life. And when I say children, I kind of mean the child in all of us. I don't just mean children.
Exactly.
So these kind of drawings remind me that we're all looking for challenges all the time. They'll visit us in our dreams if we don't have them in reality. And so we looked at children's drawings. These are drawings, some of them done by one of my sons, some of them done by production designers' children, because when you look at children's imaginations, again, we didn't want to come at this as a lot of people looking down at children in terms of telling the story. We wanted to think of ourselves as children. And so we asked children in our lives to draw the characters, and we got inspiration. You'll notice in the film that we got things like, you know, huge-headed, you know, tigers, and the reason for that was just to really feel this film from the perspective of a child. And then Rosa Bayeser Cabo, our amazing production designer, started to take both the children's imaginations, like her own daughter's drawings, and the style of the book, and started to work through it in terms of how the characters could look. Even at this phase of the design process, our storyboarders were being brought in terms of looking at this kind of work, seeing how compositions were being made. So even though we knew we weren't going to stay with this style, it was too flat for the epic kind of adventure that the characters were going to go on, and because we needed things like weight and physicality to be really present in this film, we knew we weren't going to stay this flat. But at this point, our storyboarders were already watching the work that was being done by the concept artists so that they could begin to put some of this language into the film. So again, we were too flat here, but we were already kind of exploring how pattern could work in the film. As we did that, then we began to kind of add a little bit more depth to what we were doing. So we got the sense of volume here, because again, we wanted to make sure that all of this serves a very real story purpose. The heart of My Father's Dragon is two boys. One is a dragon, but they really are just essentially two kids in a huge world that they have no control over, and they're trying to navigate through it. They're just trying to see if they can predict what's around the corner, or if they have any tools to deal with what's around the corner for them. And so even though this work bears a lot of relation to where we started from the children's drawings and from the book illustrations, you can see that we got a lot more like a bigger sense of depth in there. So this slide shows that the top left there showing where we started, and the bottom right showing where we ended up, because we did need that big sense of immersion in the film. And this is something that even our sound designers got completely on board with during the making of the film. They started to think about sound and how it could absolutely surround our audience, which would pull them into the relationship between Elmer and Boris, make them feel like they're part of that friendship. The simple kind of compositional elements were something that we brought into our character designs as well. So anytime we have a bunch of characters, that's what we think of them as, kind of like a swooping line kind of going through our compositions. An interesting kind of side note, I guess it's not really a side note when we're talking about the main character. Scott McCloud in Understanding Comics talks about how the less detail you have in a character, the more your audience can identify with them. So Elmer, as our main character, actually got a lot of corners knocked off and got simplified quite a bit in comparison to some of the secondary characters. And the reason for that is that we need our audience to really identify with Elmer. And so he became one of the simplest looking characters in the whole film, while the secondary characters were allowed to have a lot more nuance and a lot more kind of playfulness to them, because they didn't have to, they didn't have so much riding on them. They didn't have to carry so much of the emotional weight of the whole film. So Scott McCloud's point is that if he takes a picture of any one of us and puts it on a screen or on a book or whatever, that it's difficult enough to relate to that character, if you think of that as a character, whereas if you literally draw a stick man and put that up on the screen, everybody can identify that with that all the more. And so that's why we our Elmer appears more simple than a lot of the background characters. The gentle sense of kind of those lines that Rosa was bringing into the very first concepts for the film was something that even our effects designer, Narissa Shander, she also brought into the effects. So every single element, be they background elements, effects elements, or character elements, they're all following that same design motifs, that same design sensibility. And so no matter what way, or no matter what department is looking at this film, we're all looking at it with the same eyes, the same design eyes. Again, because this was done during the pandemic, it meant that every Friday we could update everybody in terms of, you know, how things were moving along, you know, especially with our storyboarding. And our storyboarders, like I said, were very much involved with the design and would see that weekly, just so that they weren't, our storyboard, our storytelling and our design weren't going off in two different directions. They were very much continuing on in the same way. You can see with the effects, how that design language was brought through it. And then we obviously did things like, you know, for example, in a scene like this, we have no rain falling directly in front of Elmer's face. Everything is, even the path that the effects animator takes to animate the rain, it accentuates Elmer and the face, which is the center of the screen. Of course, we follow basic design language as well through the film. So, you know, at the beginning of the film, we have lovely soft curves where Elmer feels safe and secure. And then as we move towards the climax of the film, we have, you know, spiky, unpredictable shapes that don't feel like a regular pattern, but have a frantic kind of movement that is less predictable, and therefore, again, it digs into the themes of like a chaotic kind of element being introduced into this kind of coming of age film where Elmer is less able to predict what's going on in his life. I just wanted to show this again, really nice. You can see again, like the beautiful curves in here where Elmer is imagining what this, you know, an amazing dragon could be, something that could solve all of his problems. You can see again the beautiful curves that are brought in there through the design work of the effects animation. And so our film would have started out its production process with a color script, as every film does. And we assigned kind of different colors to different kind of emotions and emotional states. So again, the beginning of the film has these wonderful warm golds to them, because it is such a wonderful, warm, inviting space. And then as we move on and Elmer feels less secure, there are kind of colder colors, and we pull back our palette quite a bit so that they feel less, it feels a lot less friendly. And you can see then we've come quite away from the original illustration design, and even from the idea of children's drawings, where we needed to. So the island needing to be something that it feels very, very weighty, that it sinks, you know, throughout the film. It continues to kind of sink and continues to be an unstable kind of ground underneath Elmer. And so giving it this kind of a weight that you can even see in an image like this was something that was really, really important to us. We also gave different, really strong color schemes to each area of the island, so that the sense of journey that Elmer and Boris take is very, very clear. And then when we get to, you know, moments of the film that are more somber, we literally pull the color out of that. We worked with, these aren't actually full finished backgrounds that you're looking at, these are called color keys that Anya McGuinness, our art director, and Amelia Bach, our assistant art director, made for the film. Because again, during the pandemic, if you imagine that there are background artists that are working on backgrounds that are related to each other, but they're working oftentimes in different countries, it meant that they were able to, Amelia and Anya were able to pull everybody's work together and make sure that it all looks like it was done by similar hands, so that the language, the literal brushstroke language of the film didn't change throughout, unless it was intended to do so. So there you're getting a good idea of how the artwork looked. We also a lot of the backgrounds are made either by we would scan a lot of brushwork, literal acrylic work, and then we bring them together in Photoshop in a way that our compositing artists are able to use it. So there you're getting a good idea of the different environments in the film and how they were controlled through, like I said, color keys. So that gives that's a big broad kind of look at the film from a visual perspective. And I think I'm going to leave it there in terms of that, Ben. Sound good?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Thank you for that. Let's go into some questions. So I'm not sure how to ask this one. I've been thinking about it, but this one looks different than a lot of the Cartoon Saloon films. It has a lot of similarities, but compared to, say, like Wolfwalkers and the others, like, is what why the stylistic choice?
I think each film looks like it needs to look in order for the characters to be able to go through a really satisfying story arc, an emotional arc. So with this one, the style evolved to this place because we needed an immersive world. We needed Elmer, if he's running from like a wild animal on Wild Island, we need to know how many steps there are between him and that wild animal. This film is kind of about the unpredictability of life and the chaotic elements in life, and the fact that everything isn't neat and tidy in terms of where a threat is going to come from. That dictated how this film should look So it really does come from what the needs of the characters are. We also knew that because it was it's like a very emotional screenplay, and you know the animatic was quite an emotional one. I needed to make sure that the characters as well were capable of the physical performances that I was going to ask the actors to give. And so that's why I think, you know, starting out with this film, I didn't have a look that I wanted to put on the film. I wanted the story to dictate how the film should look in order for Elmer and Boris to have that satisfying emotional journey through the film. So I think that's it. Wolf Walkers looks like it does because it's set in a very specific time, and wood block prints were a huge inspiration for it. This one, the book and children's imaginations are the inspiration for it. So it's not set in a particular time or place. If you look at Ruth's book that it's based on, it's a fantastical place. The city that Elmer lives in is called Nevergreen, and the island is called Wild Island. So that they are, to me, very imaginative, childlike spaces. And so we want to discover what that was, or we wanted to discover what that was through the design process.
Thank you. This one might be for Meg. How did you stumble on the book? Was it a childhood favorite, or? Like, what is it about this story in particular that inspired you guys to make the film?
I read it to my kids, and as I was reading it, I don't know if somebody gave it as a gift. I can't remember how it ended up in my child's room. I started to realize, oh, those images in my head that I thought were part of a dream from when I was little was actually a book that was read to me. I don't know if you guys ever have that. Like, you don't even realize it was a book that was read to you because you were so little, you have no memory of the book, but those images are in your head and the story is in your head. And I suddenly it all came flooding back as if somebody opened a door. And I remember being very small and yet feeling the incredible, empowering idea that you could be a child on an island full of wild animals who want to eat you, but you have everything you need in your backpack, and you will move forward, and you will go towards that dragon who's going to be your friend. And then there's other books in the series where they do become friends, and they fly around and have adventures. That's kind of where I started, that love and passion, and what it gave me as a child that I'd been carrying in my unconscious for so many years. And I went to my friend Julie as a producer, and her husband like flipped out because he remembered the book and loved it. So the people that remembered it loved it, and it just seemed to touch people deeply at that age, and as adults, even reading it to my kids.
Thank you. Having worked on Inside Out and then working on this one, which is more of an adaptation, what were the different challenges between an original and versus an adaptation?
Well, of course, Inside Out is Pete Docter's baby, so I'm working with genius number one, genius number two at my left here. I'm the luckiest writer alive. Inside Out is incredibly hard because there is nothing to come from. You know what I mean? Like, if you're going to do a movie under the sea, you know there's fish and kelp and sharks, and you can start there. Inside Out, like, what are you starting with? Well, it's almost too big. It was too big of options, but was kind of Pete's milieu to like start narrowing down those options in terms of the story he wanted to tell and the emotions he wanted. And so in that way, as a writer, it's the same because I'm always working for the director. I'm always working to try to help them tell their story in such a deep way that I can also relate to it and now give back in my own personal way. So. But certainly an adaptation, it's fun to start with the two characters and an island. There wasn't an animals we had, but after that all became invention because we didn't have a second act. It wasn't a movie, it was a story. It was a children's story.
Thank you. Two-part question. The funnest part of making the film and the most difficult part of making the film.
The most fun part of making a film. I never really feel like, oh, I just can't wait to get to this part because this part is like the best part and then the other parts are not so good. I really do feel like every stage, like I'm really energized where we're in the screenplay stage because it feels like, you know, we're discovering everything and, you know, anything is possible and it's always getting better and all of this. And then at a point it's like, oh my gosh, are we nearly done? Let's move on to the animatic because that's going to be the fun bit. Like, and then, you know, you get lost in that completely and can't wait to say, okay, when we get into production, it's all going to be great and all of this. So each stage I really enjoy and I am a jack of all trades. Like having, you know, gone through over 20 years in Cartoon Saloon, I know a lot about each department and the way that we do things. I do feel a huge sense of responsibility when we're recording voices because if your actors don't believe it, your animators can't believe it. You can't ask an animator to, you know, make something good of a performance that an actor doesn't believe. But I really do feel so invigorated when, you know, you get great performances and you are able to pass them on to amazing animators for the other 50% of the performance. I love being in edit because again, it just feels like there's so many possibilities. So no, I'm sorry, I can't say that I have a favorite part. I guess when we're in sound mix, but there's a pressure in sound mix, you know, to get things right. Animation takes such a long time, and then suddenly you're in mix, and decisions are really fast. And for animators and for people who work in animation, it can seem overwhelming to make a decision that is, that's it, that's for the film, in a short space of time. In terms of challenges, again, every stage has its own challenges, and certainly this film, because we had over a weekend to move the entire crew out of Cartoon Saloon and set them up in the corners of their kitchen tables and whatever. I remember moving to actually the corner of my kitchen table because I was convinced I was only going to be there for about a week or two. And so I demanded that my family were quiet and like not, you know, load the dishwasher and not, you know, not make any noise. And then it became quite apparent that it's going to be 2 years. So I took over my husband's studio and that was that. So certainly in terms of this production, the whole extra one third, I think, like Zara, line producers in the audience, so I think she would concur that I think it was about a third extra hard work, extra communication, extra kind of trying to build morale. And things just fell between one third extra cracks. You know, you have to, all animation is about communication and making sure that everybody feels fully, empowered to do their job. And in order to empower them, you need to make sure that they have enough information as to like why the character is doing what it's doing at that particular time in the film. And during a pandemic, nobody's going to ask you, you know, when you're looking at like 30 faces on a screen, and somebody doesn't understand something in a normal meeting, you'll get a little, you know, hey, what does that mean? Kind of on the shoulder or something like that. Nobody's going to ask in a screen, hey, I don't know what that thing is, that, because you feel judged, which is, it's just human nature. And so we were always trying to battle against that. So on this particular film, I think pandemic was the hardest part.
Gotcha.
For me, there's two most fun parts. The first is when you're like, let's do this. Yeah, let's put on a show, and you're blue skying how amazing it's gonna be. You have no idea how you're gonna get there, but it's super fun to imagine how great it's gonna be. And then right now, when I'm done, and look how amazing it is, and it has, and it's not that thing you imagined, because it can't be, because you had to move through all of these stages with all of these people, and it becomes Nora's, and it's better than you could have imagined, and then you get here. And in between that is a lot of challenge. We probably wrote, I don't know, 20, 30 treatments just trying to find the story. We went out to studios and were told to age it up, make it more cynical, make it more teenage boy. Which we tried, I will admit, but it didn't work, because it's not the heart of the story. And, you know, we all left it and went away and then came back. I mean, it's a 12 to 14 year process for this particular movie. All of those challenges, you know, coming to Ireland after Nora is deep in, because she, as a director, feels something else still underneath this that needs clarity in the film, which becomes the idea of fear. And how can I go in and very surgically chiropractic this to get her what she needs? But those challenges is what artistry is about. You know, it's supposed to be hard. You know, a lot of people think, well, it's hard, so I must not be very good. I shouldn't do this. No, it's the opposite. It's hard because it's art, and it is going to challenge you, and it's going to raise the bar. And as an artist, you should be pushing to raise that bar and pushing yourself to those edges, because that's what art is. It's not always fun, to answer your question. It is challenging. There's moments of incredible doubt, and this doesn't work. There's so many times, you know, when Nora's giving notes back and you're like, oh yeah, that didn't work, shoot. And then you go again and you go again, and certainly artists know about iteration. So there were moments, of course, inside that were fun with John and Nora and working with the two of them. But I would say beginning, end, fun, middle, challenging.
Thank you. You just mentioned that at some point you guys tried like aging it up, going for an older audience and all that stuff. It is, the current version is definitely a kid-friendly film. Like, what were some things that were sort of toned up or down, or how did you sort of land on the tone of the film?
I mean, I don't think that we ever, and Nora, you can disagree with me, obviously, but I don't think we ever wrote it for just little kids. We wrote it for ourselves and the child in us. We've been talking to adults who, you know, have tears in their eyes when they walk up because of how they have felt about the thematics of struggle and chaos and feeling like your world is sinking. And what do you do? I won't say what I was going to say because that would be a spoiler. You guys haven't seen the movie. There's a lot of shock. There's a lot of surprises in the movie for Elmer and for the audience. So we are speaking to all people, but we definitely wanted children to be also able to access it, right? That it really is their imagination, which is the inspiration. So I don't remember ever having a conversation about that kind of question, but Nora, you maybe can remind me.
No, I do remember trying to think of it in different ways, but it just didn't make sense. There's an earnestness to this story, but in the best possible ways. It's not a cynical film, you know, where you've got like wisecracking, you know, whatever. You know, it's not that kind of film. There is an earnest, there's a sense of, and I guess this is true of friendship at any age, but particularly the friendships that you make when you realize that your parents don't have all of the right answers and you have to go and find someone, if you're lucky, that can kind of help you through that journey, journey of discovering what's around the corner and can you face what's around the corner, and you know, can you find somebody to face that with you? There's an exhilaration in that kind of a connection that you make with somebody that makes it feel like nobody gets you like that person does, and it's the center of the universe. It is, and that's what we tried to put on the screen and put, you know, evoke with everything that we could, with the score, with the sound design, with the character animation, with the sense of immersion of the film. And that's a really honest endeavor, and I don't think we could come at that with like, oh, let's put more jokes in there for teenagers. I don't think it was something that we actually, I don't think it was ever a draft or anything like that where we kind of went, okay, let's do the teenage version.
And it's, you know, this film doesn't leave you with an easy answer. It's not a childish answer to the problem. You know, a child cannot solve an adult's problem. So it's still a very layered, complex idea. But, you know, think about fairy tales. Children, I don't think that children they don't have a frontal lobe, so they can't articulate what's happening inside of them. But all of those deep questions are happening. They are experiencing all of the same emotions and chaos and fears and friendships and inspiration that we are. And I do think children are as hungry for it and adults are hungry for it. So I think that that's what this movie can deliver.
Yeah, there was a particular page in Ruth's book, kind of early on in the book, the first, I think, 4 or 5 pages, where, and it's also in the film, where Elmer is kind to a cat, he gives a saucer of milk to a cat, and his mom just gets really angry with him. And there's so much in that, because what's going on in her life, that a saucer of milk is a big deal. And when a child looks up into a parent's face, and you know, we're parents, we know what this is, and you see the flash in the child's face that they don't recognize you for an instant. And as a child, I mean, I was also a child who looked up into my parents' face and realized they weren't telling me the entirety, you know, the whole truth at certain points, and wanting to fix what it was that was going on for them, but having no idea how to do it, and the stress of that, and the fear that invokes. And again, this is, you know, so whether you look at it as an adult or a child, there's a powerful moment there. And that moment became a linchpin for us, you know, as in terms of like, what is the tone of this film, and what, how do we tackle those layers of storytelling? So you can look at it as a magical adventure with a boy and a dragon, or you can look at it as two kids trying to figure out what the hell do they do next, and how the hell do they survive, you know, a sinking world.
Which I think adults can relate to, especially today, this feeling of the world is sinking. What do we do?
For those of us who don't know, like, can you explain a bit about the creative process between screenwriter and director? Like, what is the back and forth like with you guys?
It's I think it's different in every film, and it's different between every screenwriter and director, I would say. It is a massive, you know, journey of discovery. Working with Meg is almost like therapy, I think. And it's really interesting, because you can almost, in ways I can't describe it from the inside, because I can't observe myself, but I did see you, Meg, with another director in Cartoon Saloon, where this director has an idea for a project. And we went out to lunch with this director, and she was just, you know, just kind of skirting around, okay, this is what the idea is, and this is where I'm at with it, and this is what I don't know yet. And you just went for her in a way that I thought she was going to do this at one point, because you were just, now, and I mean this, and you know, it was not in a harsh way or anything like that, but she just very quickly began, I think within 5 minutes, she was talking about something that had happened in childhood, which I don't think she even realized had anything to do with the story or what she was circling around. And I could just see her face just change. Like, she was just immediately in a space that I'd never seen her before in. It was a very safe space, and you'd created a really safe space for her to explore that. But I was just like, okay, I'm out of my depth here. Because that's an incredible gift that screenwriters have, but Meg in particular, I think, with just cutting to the chase and getting to it. And that's what it's about, because anything else is kind of a waste of time. And this is something that you described, maybe you could talk about it, but just like the whole idea of like, you have to give something of yourself, right?
Yeah, I mean, every writer's different. Some go from the outside inside, but I, because I was trained by an actress and a director, always go to, what is this about? You know, ultimately, emotionally, not an intellectual idea, emotionally, what are you talking to me about that only you could really talk to me about, because you're giving a piece of yourself? I mean, you're going to ask the audience to have a cathartic emotional experience. Guess who has to have it first? You do. And so my job as a writer often, and I have a podcast and we call it lava, because it feels like you're going to burn up if you go in, and your brain does not want you to go there, and you're brain has done a lot of things to keep you away from it, except this story has cracked through, right? And often the intellectual brain doesn't know why the story's here. So my job is to take the hand of the director, create a safe space, and walk them into their own lava, right? Walk them into, why are you doing this? What do you love about it? What is this? What are these dream metaphors for? Until we get so deep down in that, and this is many drafts, it's not one lunch. Like, ultimately, it's many, many drafts and trying things. We might start with a word like friendship, And that becomes, okay, what's under friendship? Well, you're really talking about trust. Okay, what's underneath the trust? What are you talking about? Okay, I'm talking about chaos and control. Okay, what's under chaos and control? All very personal to that director, personal to me. And even as we are going and she's starting to be into board, she's understanding that, oh, there's something underneath this. Because ultimately that character's transformation, what happens to them at the end of Act Two, what they wake up to, is what you're talking about. And once you have that, it starts to create the structure. It creates arc, it creates the colors. It's creating everything else that Nora is describing today is coming from that well of what is this about emotionally? What is happening to Elmer? Because that's what we want to have happen to the audience. So I love structure. I love thinking about what's the fun scenes we can write, but I don't know what those are until we at least have something to talk about what this is about. And we can start with just a word like friendship, and we'll do a treatment or a draft based on that. But as we go, things just keep bubbling up and bubbling up. And I feel like that is my job as the writer, is certainly to execute the scenes, but I personally can't execute those scenes if I don't know what emotionally is happening right now to this character. Even if we're just guessing, even if we're just, okay, in this version, let's try this. So it's always kind of a walk in the woods without a path. But that's also why it's fun, right? Because it's a process of discovery for both of us.
In storyboard, then there's a whole other layer of it, where things that were in the screenplay might be like a paragraph of description, might become a look between two characters, or we might lose it because, you know, or there might be lines that we lose or whatever. But they're all still along that backbone. Usually, things can fall apart in animatic. That often happens, and then you have to go back and then do a kind of a two-handery thing where it's like, you know, back into pages at the same time as going back into boarding, and then it can feel like you've got a lot of plates up in the air. But so long as you knowing what that in terms of like the big themes of the film. And continuing to kind of burrow down into those means that your storyboarders know exactly why they're going at every, you know, sequence in the film, how the sequence up front relates to the sequence that's happening in the third act. And so you just continue to burrow down and burrow down just in a series of passes until it's all really, really distilled, I think, at that point.
Yeah, I mean, it's really fun to write first acts. It's like that thing I talked about where it's all blue sky. It's going to be great. We're in the first act. But the truth is you don't know your first act until you know your third act. And you don't know your first act until you know that end of act two and that realization and that what is this about. And then everything gets recalibrated back to that. I mean, often, I don't know if, Nora, you have found this with Cartoon Saloon movies, but I know at Pixar, that first scene is often the last thing that you get because it's, in a weird way, containing the whole movie, right? And all that work you've done. So, you have to be kind of daring to just keep writing even though you don't know where we're going right now. Like I have and until eventually you do get that rudder. And it's very important to me that that rudder be the director's versus the writer's. If it's a deep human rudder about the truth of the human condition, I will feel it too and it will be mine, but it's gotta come from the director.
Thank you. Before we go to you guys' this question, I'm going to ask one more. The cast was great, and how, like earlier on, did you already know who you wanted, and who was the most difficult to cast?
I think they were all pretty easy to cast, actually. Yes, did I know early on? No. In fact, I was kind of shying away from the bigger names because I don't think, you know, you're going to get enough access to people like, you know, Whoopi Goldberg or Rita Moreno. I love like a really good workspace for doing the voice records. And I wasn't sure how that was going to go with like, you know, big stars, basically. But Amy Lippins, our casting director, was really adamant that it could work really, really well. And she also had her eye on Jacob Tremblay from you know, from his days in Room and Wonder, and so and the same with Gayton. And so she began to kind of bring together this kind of mosaic, or this, you know, of different different actors whose voices sounded really good together. We would do things like, you know, have our character design here, and we would just like take a piece of the performance from a different film or something like that, and just look at the character design while listening to the voices, and then start to cut them together, you know, with each other as well, even though it was really ridiculous sounding, because it would be, you know, Gayton's Stranger Thing performance, you know, with, you know, Jacob's Wonder performance or something like that. So the lines had nothing to do with each other, although it's funny how the human brain works, and it kind of was creating connections between them, and we would just literally cut between the character designs. And that kind of gave us the confidence to know that, you know, that the cast could work really well. And Amy is just to go out there and ask the people, you know, person. And so, you know, everyone said yes. But then what was a real revelation for me is that, you know, Rita Moreno just wants to play. She is a child at heart. She has tremendous energy. She has like a huge, you know, comedy bone that no matter, even if she's dealing with like a harsh character, she's just able to do things with the pronunciation of her words that just brings a little edge of comedy to it, so that even though, you know, she's just amazing. The same with Ian McShane. They're all very different, and as a director you have to respond to them very differently. In that same room you have to be whatever they need you to be in order to get the great performance from them. So I think that's how we kind of came to that process. But I don't know, Meg, whether you were thinking about characters when we were...
Sometimes I do, if it helps me just start, you know, if I think of an actress or an actor, and then generally, hopefully, the character takes over, and that actress can evaporate because the character's now speaking to me. I think the one that was the most similar in my head to what I heard is Ian McShane as the gorilla. It was so crazy. It was exactly like what I heard in my head, and he's so good. And the other thing that talk about winning the lottery, when you guys see it, the score of this movie is unbelievable. It is so beautiful. It is a very big part of the movie, and the Dana brothers just did truly an amazing, inspiring job.
Very cool, thank you. All right, let's open it up to some audience questions. Yes, go ahead. You with the glove? I'm gonna repeat the question, or if you'd the question, you can.
It's about whether the actors came to Ireland, is that right? And then how we built the camaraderie between myself and the actors, is that right?
Given the pandemic.
Different time zones. Yeah, they're great questions. We were lucky enough, because that animation takes such a long time, that there was no pandemic, and we hadn't heard of COVID-19 when we started recording the actors. So it was 2019, I think, Sarah, if I'm correct. The last couple of months, I think, of 2019, am I right? So that's when we recorded the actors. We did the first pass, then we went back into some rewriting, having done a couple of passes of animatic, gone back into rewriting, and then we did a lot of pickups with the actors remotely. But at that point, I already had a relationship with pretty much all of them, except Alan Cumming, who plays the crocodile. I still haven't met him in person. So I was able to be in the same room with them all, which is great. They're also extremely professional. I think if I was working with somebody who hadn't a lot of experience, I would probably need to spend a lot of time in rehearsal with them. But actors of that caliber are just—they're ready to hit the ground running. The trust is the biggest thing with anybody who's acting. I think to be able to create a space that your actors feel safe and that they can trust you as a director, and that you know what you're doing. That's the biggest thing, but at that, you know, at that caliber of actor, they come fully prepared. For example, Ian McShane was literally, you know, really physical in those performances. He would run through those pages, and I had to keep up with him all the way through. And then in terms of coming to Ireland, no, I came out here to record them first off, and then our pickups were done remotely. For other, you know, for Wolfwalkers, I think they were recorded in Ireland and they went to like a separate space. I generally like to separate out my actors and use myself like acting opposite them for the different parts, because then I can help control, you know, things like how much, you know, if a character is running, how far away they are from the camera, all of that kind of energy I can control if I'm one-to-one with an actor. But with the two boys, with Elmer and Boris Gayton and Jacob, we recorded them together because they had such a magic energy together. And they had a kind of older sibling, younger sibling kind of relationship and a genuine fondness for each other. And they shared the same humor. And so that's we got to record them together. So I was lucky that a lot of this happened just before the pandemic.
Go ahead, you had.
That's a great question. So the portion of the film, so about 30 minutes were animated in France, and how did we decide on what they did versus what we did. We tried to give as big a chunks. Zara, you should really be sitting up here with me, because it was Zara, our line producer, and our production manager and our head of animation that kind of made the decisions as to what bits we would give our studio in France. Now, we had worked with a lot of the animators there on different productions anyway. And they had worked on Wolfwalkers as well, so we knew a lot of their animators. We know the studio pretty well. We tried to give them as big chunks as we possibly could give them, and they started after we started in Cartoon Saloon, so they knew the style of the animation. They knew what, like, how Elmer would take off his backpack. All of those kind of conversations we had with them. And then their supervisor, David, would also be on every call that we had with all of our scenes that were going through our dailies process. So any of our scenes that were being looked at, he was part of that process. So even if we weren't talking about scenes that were directly related to what his animators were doing, he knew. So he was completely brought on board with all of our decisions. So he wasn't excluded from anything. And the same with their team. We really did try to treat them as we're all one team. The most dangerous thing that can come into an animation production is when you start talking about, like, they as in the other, and you have to always look at it, no matter where people are working from or what their discipline is, or whether you feel that, you know, that you know what they're doing is helpful or whatever. It's all for the one film, and we're all working towards the one frame, and so like a huge part of our entire process was making our partners in France feel very much like part of the process and as important as any other part of the process. Thank you. So the question is, were there benefits to having this film be done, you know, remotely? Because, so yes, there are definitely, I think, benefits. One of them, which is really a funny one, Maybe I just think it's funny, but so usually in a meeting, if we're all sitting around a table like this and somebody's presenting something on the screen and they're saying, okay, we've got this, we're in effects department and we've got this problem with our effects, and I'm there thinking, oh, I really would just love to take the mouse now and go on Google and say, oh, I think I saw something on YouTube once that was kind of like that. Or else I'd want to go on my phone and do it. But I would never do that in a meeting because it would look so disrespectful if I suddenly start, you know, scrolling through my phone. So what's fantastic with the whole pandemic kind of production thing is that somebody on a call like that would be doing exactly that. And before whoever it is that says what the problem is has that problem even fully explained, somebody has found a solution or some piece of reference or something that helps. And has put that up in the chat box, which is amazing. And I think that's really, it's really great. For me though, it did seem like a lot of really hard work. When I moved back to the studio as quickly as I could, because even though it was lovely to be, you know, in my own house and be able to, like, you know, put on my own kettle and make my own tea and all this kind of stuff, like I felt isolated, and especially as a director, I felt really isolated. And so I moved back the first chance I could. It was kind of hilarious that I moved back because I moved into a windowless room that had big screens so I could review really well. I might as well have been at home because there were so few people in the studio. But one person that was in the studio, there was a couple of animators at that point back. And I remember being in a meeting about there's a kind of a dream like sequence in the film, and it's very beautiful. We're working with an amazing animator on part of it, and we had a video meeting, even though he was just in another room, but other people weren't. So we had a video meeting with him about tackling that sequence. And so, you know, he was going to do X amount of work by the following week and all of that. And then after that meeting, I went to have a cup of tea. So I put on the kettle, that animator came out, and I asked him how he was, and he said, oh, I'm good. But I could see in his shoulders he wasn't good. He was holding tension. So as the kettle was boiling, we were talking about the scene, and it transpired. It was more work than I thought it was going to be. He was having second thoughts about maybe being able to complete it by the time frame that it needed to be complete. So by the time the kettle had boiled, we'd like talked about how he's a brilliant, brilliant animator. He had nothing to prove to anybody, you know, least of all me. There was people that we could get to help, you know, finish that, you know, that amount of work. And so by the time we both walked away with our cups of tea, problem solved, but a problem that I would not have known about had we just, like, you know, had I not seen him in person, because he's a great animator, but lots of creatives overburden themselves, don't know how long things take. I still have trouble telling you how long something's going to take, and I've been doing this for over 20 years. So I think there's pros and cons to it. I like having people around. I like being able to see what people are doing, but you're right, there are great things in that I got to work with people that I couldn't have worked with in normal circumstances. Thank you.
My mother kept something that I wrote. It was a story. It was like three sentences long, and the letters were literally like 2 inches big because I'm so little. I think I said I got on a plane and fell in a hole. I didn't ever have written on a plane at that point, and I look back and I'm like, you maybe should have taken me to therapy if that was my first story. But they didn't have that back then. So I've always been telling stories. I've always been a storyteller. I say that, and yet I went to school to be a screenwriter, and then as soon as I graduated, I thought, I have no stories to tell. This is too scary. I can't do it. And I became an executive instead. And I became a producer, and I worked for Jodie Foster for 10 years, and then woke up one day and said, oh my gosh, I don't want to be 85 and wonder what if. I need to try to go back to that person I was and give it a chance, right? Even if you fail, at least I know I tried. So I quit this huge Hollywood job huge Hollywood job. Everybody thought I was insane. And it took, I don't know, 3 to 5 years of learning to write, because just because you want to do it, it's a craft, you have to learn it. But then it worked out, right?
I always drew as a child, but I didn't know that there was something that you could do called animation that was a job, or because there kind of wasn't in Ireland back in the 80s. And so I continued to draw. There's a kind of a drop-off point around the age of 10 or 11 where a lot of children stop drawing and, you know, find different ways of communicating and different ways of figuring the world out around them. And then some people don't. Some people who kind of need to draw and need to kind of have that way of communicating. And so I continued to do that. But I left school when I was 15 with no qualifications. I was a really hopeless case when it came to kind of the academic life. I couldn't find a way in or anything, you know, in terms of how my skills were going to transpire into anything. I went and worked in factories for a number of years and then earned up enough money to go back as kind of a mature student in my early 20s and then discover the path to animation through fine art initially, and then in through animation. Then I met the people that I still work with today in college, and that's how I kind of got back in. So I fell pretty, you know, severely fell down and then got back up again. So
so the question was, when we had that period of people asking us to age up the film, and how did we eventually get it to where it is and on Netflix? When we first took it out, this is how long ago it was, they're asking us to age it up in terms of cynicism, if that makes sense, and kind of self-referential, and, you know, and I love those movies, but that's not what this is. There was no Paddington Bear, hadn't come out yet, so there were... After we realized we can't age it up, and I went and started writing on Inside Out, these other movies came out that showed that movies that appeal to younger audiences can also make money, just to be blunt about it. And so it gave us a little door, I think. And when we first went out, I don't think there were streamers. Mm. That's how long ago we went out. There were no streamers. So you were just going to the kind of big five, and a lot of those, and some of those animation houses don't take pitches, right? They only develop inside. So that starts to limit out them. So we got very lucky in that I'm coming off Inside Out, which did well. The Paddington Bear had come out, and so they could see an option. And Netflix is starting an animation company, and I think we were one of the first ones they said they would do. I don't think they even had an animation branch yet. We were pitching to the live action executives. So it was a bit of luck. The universe turned the wheel and said, we'd like this movie to be made. We're gonna line up some dominoes for you. So we did, sometimes that does happen. But it wouldn't have happened if we had given up, right? If we hadn't come back together, rejigged the story in terms of gone even deeper, really worked on a great pitch. And, you know, the pitch in the room, we made the executives cry in the room, right? So it really was a good pitch that we did.
Yeah, but I think it's important to hang on to integrity as well. Like if you're being asked a question, like, you know, kind of thing, oh, well, we don't think this sells, so like you have to do it that way or whatever. There's something about, like, animation takes so long, you have to really believe in what you're doing in order to just motivate yourself to get up and go into work and do it. So I don't think I could have motivated myself for 5 years or, you know, of actual, like, from screenplay to final film if I didn't, you know, feel that there was something that I desperately wanted to communicate with this film that did feel very personal, to the point that it feels personal on the screen. I don't think and oftentimes in this industry you can be asked to, you know, pull things one way or another because exactly this is what's making money or this isn't what's making money. Those types of, you know, pieces of advice tend to be a little bit behind the curve all the time. Like, it's like, oh, this thing made money this year, but like, by the time your film comes out, it's going to be maybe 5 years down the line. If there isn't that integrity in what you're doing, and you've done something for something that fits a market from 5 years ago, it's not, you know, it's not going to do anything. And so, there's a lot of people wanting to tell you what you should do, or and what your thing, you know, what your film or whatever should be about, but it has to come from within you, and then you can't let that be swayed by somebody telling you, oh, but we need this other thing that you have to be able to understand, like, what's good advice and what's like what good notes are versus what aren't, you know, notes that feel right with you.
And to be fair to those executives at first, I don't know that we had the depth of the story that we had by the time we went back out a second time, meaning they knew in the room that they could feel it in the room. So letting her take that was just going to get better. Like, they could feel it in the room that even it gives the empowers the executives to go to their boss and say, I know, but this story is important. It's emotional. We were crying. And those do move, right? Because people have attached to them emotionally. So that stuff that we were talking about, lava and digging deeper into that stuff that makes you feel very vulnerable, that stuff does tend to get move because they can feel it when they read it. They can feel it when you're pitching it to them. And, you know, they hear pitches all day long. To make them feel something is revelatory sometimes to them.
Okay, sure, go ahead.
Is there anything in particular about the sound design that you're excited for the audience to experience?
It's such good sound design, you guys. I can't even.
The sound design is amazing. It's by Zach Sievers and Justin Davey of Snap Sound, and they just did an incredible job. What was great, actually, about working with Netflix is that we were able to bring them on earlier than we would normally have brought on. That we'd have normally been able to afford to bring on, and then we got to mix in a fantastic soundstage in the Fox slot as well. So they were able to, and again, they were digging into exactly the things that Meg is talking about. You know, fear, chaos, order, wanting to know what's around the corner, two small kids in a big world. All of those themes is like those were the same, you know, words and sentences that Zach and Justin used to begin to develop the world of the sound design. They had nothing to start with because, again, you know, Wild Island doesn't exist, Nevergreen doesn't exist, but they were able to do things like bring the animal sounds of Wild Island back into the city of Nevergreen. Like they linked things up in a similar way to the way that Elmer's emotional arc is threaded throughout, you know, the backbone of this film. They also threaded the sound design in throughout it. They did amazing things, like they broke apart wicker chairs to form the sound of the island sinking. So that's what they recorded, and then they played them back at different speeds. And they just did things that I couldn't imagine. But they also worked, closely with, like, listening to the score as it was being created, and the demos were being created for the score. So they knew not to kind of step on, you know, nobody was stepping on anybody else's toes. We knew when we were relying on sound design, when we were relying on score, when we were relying on actor performance, when we were relying on silence. All of these things have to live in a really beautiful harmony and in a sense of rhythm, so that nothing is overwhelming at any point, and that it all runs along. You know, the screenplay and the animatic. You know, you can. We have this. I don't have it in our presentation that we had today, but when we started the animatic, we broke it down into, you know, what the arc is, the emotional roller coaster of the film, what that arc is, you know, from the screenplay and then, you know, onto the animatic. And then, you know, for developing the color script, we use that emotional arc. For for the sound design as well, we used it so that it just builds and builds. And there's an expression that Boris uses in the film about feeling it in the pit of his stomach. And I think you feel the sound design in the pit of your stomach because it's literally the approach that they took. They really did an astounding job with this. Thanks.
Isn't that cool that they used wicker? Like, cause if you think about it, have you ever sat in a wicker chair and you're like, oh my gosh, this is going, right? Like, we intuitively have a sense of wicker breaking is a sinking feeling, and that they're so smart emotionally, right? That they were like, what will make the sound of a fearful sinking? Cause he was saying, what does an island sinking sound like? Nobody knows. Like, I just thought it was so amazing.
I have a question from Twitch. How did the process of making the film and meeting Ruth, the author, make you see and treat the film differently?
I think as Meg explained, we didn't really want to take the approach of, well, this happens on this page of the book and therefore it needs to happen on this this minute of the film. When I went to visit Ruth, it was more to ask her about Elmer and Boris, and what was it about their friendship, what was it about their characters that really she wanted to get across to her readers, and then what was it that she thought that they generations of people like Meg, reading it as a child and then going on to read it to her children, like, what was that? That's what I wanted to ask her. But even before I met her, I got a sense of who she is. I went to the village of Trumansburg in upstate New York and stayed in a little guest house before I went out to meet Ruth. And the woman who ran the guest house had been taught to read by Ruth. Ruth had... She had spent decades in this beautiful yellow house with her husband Peter and her seven daughters, but she had also made time to go to the local schools so that any child who was having difficulty learning to read, that she was there for them and she was able to instill in them or to encourage in them a love of books, a love of characters, a love of their own autonomy and choice, the choices that they make. What are they interested in? What are the books that they're interested in? What are the characters that they're interested in? And then help them to read those and to open those doors and to find windows into those worlds. When I got to Ruth, she had made bread that day, and we sat and we ate the bread and drank soup together. And she took me around her house and took me into her barn where she had made all of these amazing little villages for her grandchildren and her great grandchildren, just little shops, just incredibly creative, imaginative, the handmade little stores and things. You know, she has the imagination of a child. She placed such importance on her own imagination, on my imagination, and on children's imaginations. When she first wrote that book, back in 1948, nobody would ask a child what they thought of anything or how they felt they could survive anything or anything really. So for her to write a book about a child who had everything that he needed in his backpack, who had the ability to save somebody else and save himself in the process, these are the things that really struck me. She read me, she took out some of the letters that people had written to her over the years, you know, people for whom Elmer and Boris had really struck a chord. And for them, it was very much that Elmer wasn't a superhero. He didn't have, Boris doesn't have a six-pack. Elmer isn't a superhero. He's just an ordinary kid. And he uses his own resourcefulness to change his circumstances. He uses his own generosity to change what happens to him and how he deals with that and what his own reaction to that. So I think these were the things that I took from Ruth rather than this happens on that page.
Any other questions? Okay, sure, go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
So the question is, in Wolfwalkers, we had wolf vision, and that was incredibly challenging. And then how did we have challenges that were similar with this? We had the challenge of the island sinking and wanting that to feel not like like a cutout or something. We wanted it to feel really weighty, and that the mortality of Elmer was something that we really felt, you know, with the sinking of the island. Victor Parades, who's a fantastic animator and supervisor, who worked on this project and has also developed and owns Moho software, which is a rig software that we used on this film for things like the island itself, so that we could break it apart in ways that didn't interfere with the art direction that Anya had put in place. But that it gave enough of sense of like real physical weight on that island, that you really felt that sinking, so that we earned the wicker basket, the wicker furniture, kind of sense of the world being pulled out from under you, or that sinking feeling in your stomach that makes you feel almost sick, that we earned that kind of feeling. He also worked really closely with Narissa Shander, our effects designer and supervisor, so that she could get a sense of scale in there with it. But all the way back to like the location design for things like, we have this crocodile river that you literally see kind of pull apart. It starts out being very patterned, you know, very patterned. And then the island has one of its sinking episodes, and that whole area literally pulls apart. But there was such amazing teamwork on this film. Antonio, who's our location designer, who made sure that the departments down the line, so Victor's department and Narissa's department, weren't going to fall into trouble. She just did an amazing job with the location design and with our layout as well. To just put the plans in place that meant that it didn't fall apart when it was falling apart, when it fell apart in the right ways. So the care that each supervisor and team member had for the next department coming along the line meant that we didn't end up in a heap of trouble when we got into, you know, compositing. We were in trouble, of course. Every production is always in trouble, but it was manageable trouble. And so I think that was our wolf vision. I think the island pulling apart and sinking down was our wolf vision, I think. Thank you.
All right, I'm going to ask the last question. You've both worked on great films. What are some lessons you've learned from your previous films that you told yourself, okay, I'm going to remember this for my next one?
Yeah, you always think it's going to be different. This one will be easy. What I learned in the previous films that I brought to this that helped me was iteration. This is going to be a lot of iteration. It's going to be a lot of changing. Don't hold on too tight. The Elmer in me who wants to control it and fix it and solidify it and no chaos, and that you do have to just, because that's the digging process, that's the expansion. Things expand and contract. And just to take that ride with it. And it's not that there weren't days that it wasn't scary, but that iterative process and allowing it to just keep generating and changing, I learned at Pixar, which is a kind of play, and that you've got to play with it and let it speak back to you and be part of the story is creating itself too. So that play experience at Pixar definitely helped.
Yeah, I kind of learned that it's better not to have a pandemic in the middle of a production, so I'm going to try not to have one the next time around. It's interesting, like after every project in Cartoon Saloon, we do what's called a postmortem, which isn't a great phrase for it, but it's like, so a lot of our heads of department, and it's generally led by technical direction. So like what went right and what went wrong and what we can, you know, what should we keep doing and what should we stop doing, and you know, all of this. And they're great, but you really can't tell what the problems are going to be on the next production. And it really is, because every story is different. You know, there's so much experience that you can bring to every production, but you have to be wide open that there could be a whole bunch of other types of problems on this next one. And that's not anybody's fault. That's just you know, we're working in a creative industry. We're all the time trying to push the envelope. We're all the time trying to, you know, we're not, you know, going over the same ground over and over again, because I think once we start to do that, that will be the death of us, you know. So with that kind of, you know, idea of just going out and exploring more, that means you're going to make more mistakes, but you just have to be supportive of each other and know that, you know, with all the iterations, that there are also going to be, you know, a lot of problems, but to, you know, go at those wholeheartedly with a really supportive mindset, you know, for the people that you're working with, that's the most important thing.
All right, thank you very much. And with that, let's give them a round of applause. So we're going to go ahead and go straight into the signing portion, unless you guys want to take a break or anything like that.